music was always a big thing, obviously. You know, my dad, age six, gave me Sgt. Pepper's and said, listen to this, this is music. And my mum, I remember listening, she had Bridge Over Troubled Water, the album on vinyl. But in terms of guitar, we had a shop in chain in England called W.H. Smith's, posters, and there was a poster of Paul Weller at the Jam, sort of mid-leap, and it was such a powerful image, you know, probably about 78. And then in terms of wanting to play the guitar, it was hearing The Police, and it was hearing Andy Summers, and it was hearing Walking on the Moon, and it was hearing kind of this sound, you know, that evoked somewhere that was different, otherworldly, somewhere. It was like a track that you heard on the moon. And then I sort of was pulled in probably by his playing, and kind of what he was doing sonically was really, was amazing. And that's when I was just like, you know, you suddenly like, the guitar suddenly becomes the coolest object in the universe. It was always sound for me. I guess the first person really was Andy Summers, what he was doing texturally and stuff. And then of course, you know, you get to The Edge, who was huge and massively important, and Johnny Marr, all people who were, it was about the song. And taking these songs, these emotive songs, and putting an atmosphere on them, or taking them somewhere else that was really unique, these kind of, these sonics, the sound within the context of a great song. I got my first Strat, it was a Squire Strat, and it was 1986. This Squire Strat was about £180, and I saved up and I got it. And it was black with a white pickguard, and I don't think it was the nicest neck, but I loved it, I didn't give a shit. And I had that all the way through until 1995, when all our gear was nicked in a yellow Penske van. So I played it on Pablo Honey and on the Benz. And then we had a week, we came to LA, we're picking up another tour. We just finished the REM tour opening up for them. I went up to San Francisco, and there was a Clapton Strat with the Fender lace sensors and the mid boost. And so I bought a black one of those, and I loved it. And it's an amazing guitar. It was a proper, you know, it, like the Squire Strat was brilliant, and I'm so thankful for it, because it afforded me, I would have never have been able to spend 600 quid, you know, in 87. I only had 170 quid, so it did the job. I got the look, but I got the quality, and then the mid boost, and I love those lace sensor pickups. And I used that on OK Computer. I think the Strat is, if you're going to have, you know, for someone like myself who colours a lot of his sounds and I use a lot of effects, it's like the benchmark, it's the yardstick. It doesn't flavour it, the sound, so there's a, and also I think with the Strat, with the differences between the pickups, it covers such a tonal range that it's just genius for, you know, you've got the guitar, you don't have to worry about the guitar, you can concentrate on what pedals or whatever you put it through. And also, I've got to say, the feel of it. I mean, I love the feel of it. When you get a great body and it sits in there, and it's just, you've got all the curves, and it just feels right. And then, you know, what's great about what modifications we've done is, you know, on Kid A, wanted to get away from a traditional guitar sound, and Fernandez made a sustainer kit, so Plank bore out all the stuff in the necessary work to do on my Clapton Strat, and we fitted the sustainer in there, and you know, and went away, and it became, I've had that for 14 years, so it's an album that I've used on everything since then, and it's a go-to. It's always, if you want it for me, if I don't want a guitar, if I want to get textural and I want to get more into kind of keyboard territory, I just go to the sustainer. And it's got to be in the Strat, because it's also the tremolo arm is essential. It's just, and it becomes, again, because you're not using your right hand much, you know, you might ping a string just to get it going, but again, it's with the curves and the contours of the Strat and the neck and the way it sits, it becomes, you know, you're like, it's a feel thing. You don't even think about, you know, it's bend notes. It's really, it's, I can't, it wouldn't happen on any other guitar for me. This fairly nutty theory, but I think all songs exist, and you just got to tap in there, dial in the frequency to find it. And I think that's what I feel about the Strat design, is that there's like a perennial kind of, like with great design, it's like, it's always been there. It's, you know, it's not forced, it's just you feel it. It's like the Strat, it feels like the Strat was like plucked from the ether. It's always been there, you know, and it transcends genres, it transcends ages, because it's right, you know. I, you know, start with a guitar, so I start with a true guitar, one that speaks to me, so it'll be the Strat probably. And then make sure I've got a good amp. So on the last tour, I used Vibra Kings. And in my humble opinion, it's the finest big amp out there. I'd had a setup that I hadn't changed for years and years and years, since the very beginning, since 92. I A-B'd it with the Vibra Kings, had a day in our studio. And to me, I was just like, this is the one. And the reason I sort of went for it was because I remember it. It was just, I remember seeing, watching Live 8, but a Live 8, whenever that was, 2005. And Pete Townsend's guitar sound was just off the scale. To me, it was the finest sound there. And I was just like, okay, what's he playing? And it's just like, well, he's got a Clapton Strat. And what's that thing? And then, oh, it's a thing called a Vibra King. I'd never heard of a Vibra King. And so I was, you know, intrigued. And then it works great with my setup, because it's great if you go straight into it, but also with coloring it with effects and stuff like that, it works great as well. And then you start building up your pedals or whatever, and then that's a feel thing, you know, that's kind of, it's a feel thing and an addiction. I love delays, so I love the character of different delays. I'm very, very picky about delay sounds and reverbs. And I'm not like, you know, just an analog head. I love digital. And I like it now, like a lot of the boutique pedal makers are doing stuff. It's a feel thing. It's a feel thing. And then I'll do a little bit of, you know, if there's a pedal out there, sort of every 2 or 3 months, I'm usually sort of trying to see if there's anything new out there, and then might YouTube it and go, okay, see what someone's done on it. And every time we go and do a record, I like to bring something new, like sonically, that I'm excited about. I love finding sounds, but you can only do that if you're inspired. So for me, I'm in heaven 4 hours, and I won't take up studio time doing it. I'll get in early, and in rehearsals or whatever, I'll get there early, and I just finding sounds, and like, you know, and then find something that's appropriate or moves me, and jot that down, make a note of what the settings are. But I find that when you find a great sound, it's very, very visual, you know? Like, I know when something really resonates, because it suddenly becomes visual and I imagine something. It could be the bottom of the ocean, it could be a lawn in midsummer in Britain, you know? It's really interesting. I remember on one song, it was, because we're just outside LA, it was, you know that film Big Lebowski? That scene when he gets really high and he flies over LA, it's just like, I found this sound, it was just like, that's the sound. I'm like flying over this metropolis, this cityscape, and it's LA, and it's, you know, I know when it's happening, because it suddenly becomes, it becomes more than just a sound. It's an emotion, and it's accompanied by sort of quite strong visuals.